Well, I want to share a message with you, and then we're going to have communion at the end of our service today. But for those who were with us last week, I didn't get to finish going into Joy to the World, and I just wanted to touch base on Joy to the World, because it's a great song that we didn't get a chance to really touch base on. So I'm going to pray, and then I'm going to get straight into it. Got a lot to get through to this morning, so let me do that. Father God, thank you again that we can gather. And Lord, just a great to hear from me and just the update of Tobias and Josie. And we want to pray again for them. But Lord, we ask right now that as we look at these couple of Christmas songs, as we look at your word and what your word has to say, that you again will just remind us of just how special it is to be followers of you. That Father, you're for us and not against us. And that the whole reason of Christmas is for us, Lord, that you came to this earth that we may have life and have it to the full. And we thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, well, let's get stuck into this. So first of all, the interesting when it comes to the song Joy to the World, who was written by Isaac Watts, it actually wasn't written for a Christmas carol at all. It wasn't part of a Christmas carol setting at all, but it was something different. But let me give you a bit of background. So basically, it was written for basically from a Psalms book, which it was. So Isaac Watts, when he was young, he complained about the quality of songs in church. And the following week, his parents challenged him to actually put a song together, and he actually did that. And he actually began to put a whole bunch of songs together. And I think over the past, there was about 600-plus hymns that he's actually put together. But at about age of 20, he presented his first hymn to the church and received an enthusiastic response. And this began his career of what has been known as the father of English hymns. So in 1674, his father was in prison, and he was for non-conformist sympathies. In other words, he would not embrace the established Church of England. And so young Isaac grew up with his dad in prison because of this. Young Isaac Watts was an incredibly smart kid. He was a genius. In fact, he was studying Latin, French. Just think about this. Latin, French, Greek, and Hebrew by the age of 13, okay? Several wealthy townspeople offered to pay for him to go to university and educated, but he actually refused to do that and ended up going into Anglican ministry. He spent about 6 years as a private tutor, and then around about 1702, he became the pastor of an influential independent church of London, which he served for the rest of his life. In 1712, serious illness in 1712 brought Watts to the home of Sir Thomas Abney, and there he remained for life, tutoring the children and pastoring his nearby church when he was physically able. Poor health caused him to abandon the ministry for about 4 years, but he pastored for 50 and was admired as a teacher. Gives you a bit of insight of the guy. In 1707, he published a collection of 210 hymns entitled Hymns and Spiritual Songs, one of the first English hymn books. And it was in about 1719 that he actually published the Psalms of David, imitated in the language of the New Testament. And basically in doing that, he tried to put music to all the Psalms. He tried to put music to the things that he read in Scripture. Thus, he composed a whole bunch of songs, including Joy to the World, which we're going to look at in a moment. When I Survey the Wondrous Cross, This is the Day the Lord Has Made, a whole bunch of them, over 600 of these songs. And it's interesting because as he was growing up, he's been quoted as saying this, and this is really interesting. It's different language today, but he quoted this to say that he said, "To see the dull indifference, the neglect and thoughtless air that sits upon the faces of the whole assembly, while the psalm is upon their lips, might even tempt a charitable observer to suspect the fervency of their inward religion." In other words, he was saying, people aren't getting it. Like, this is the word of God, and yet people are just sitting there with dull looks on their face. Even when we sing it, they've still got dull looks on their face. So anyway, after battling a whole bunch of illness, it was about Watts died in 1748. But the song that he wrote, Joy to the World, which we sing at Christmas, is a hymn that was paraphrasing the last five verses of Psalm 98. So Psalm 98, let's have a look at it. It says, "Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Burst into jubilant song with music. Make music to the Lord with the harp and the sound of singing, with trumpets and the blast of the ram's horn. Shout for joy before the Lord the King. Let the sea resound and everything in it, in the world, and all who live in it. Let the rivers clap their hands. Let the mountains sing together for joy. Let them sing before the Lord, for he comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness and the peoples with iniquity. So out of that psalm, in his genius state, he actually penned the words to joy to the world. And this is it. He says, joy to the world, the Lord has come. Let earth receive her king. Let every heart prepare him room, and heaven and nature sing. Joy to the world, the Saviour reigns. Let men their songs employ, while fields and floods, rocks, hills and plain repeat the sounding joy. And this is a verse that's not in the current, Christmas singing of the joy to the world, but this is a verse that he put in there as well, which doesn't get the Guernsey these days. But no more let sins and sorrows grow, nor thorns infest the ground. He comes to make his blessing flow, far as the curse is found. And then he goes on, he rules the world with truth and grace and makes the nation prove the glories of his righteousness and wonders of his love This is the song that we sing at Christmas, joy to the world, based around the Psalms, basically almost talking more about the end times rather than the Christmas times. But this is a great song that declares the fact that Jesus is who he says. And we're going to do it. We're going to do things a little bit different right now. But let's stand and let's sing joy to the world as we've got on the screen today. Let's do that and remind ourselves how it was put together. I sing it myself, but I needed you to sing it with me to help with that. So it's interesting that this song, as I said, was with some of the history, just for me, makes it even more significant as we sing it around Christmas time. Well, another song I want to focus on as well as we look at this in more detail today is by a gentleman by the name of John Henry Hopkins, Jr., and this is around the 1800s. And he was born in Pittsburgh in Pennsylvania and received his education in Vermont in General Theological Seminary, and he graduated in 1850. Now, Hopkins became the first church instructor of General Theological Seminary. It was founding editor of the Church Journal in 1853. Now, there's a big significance about that this was, he was the first person basically to be given the authority to do a lot of the music side of things. And he was recognized at a whole bunch of different churches as a church musician. So almost one of the first worship leaders, I guess, if you want to put it that way, of musicians within the church. He became the first he first served in two different churches as well during his time as a rector. And the song that we're going to focus on right now is the We Three Kings was written originally for a Christmas pageant. So basically he had a Christmas pageant organized and he wanted to do it so he could have the young boys dress up with their crowns and gifts and choir. And the whole thing was he wanted to write this that could be used in a Christmas play. And he focused around the scripture that we read today from Matthew chapter 2. And I'm going to read it through from the Message translation again. And it says, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem village, Judea territory, this was during Herod's kingship. A band of scholars arrived in Jerusalem from the east. They asked around, where can we find and pay homage to the newborn king of the Jews? We observed a star in the eastern sky that signaled his birth. We're on a pilgrimage to worship him. When the word of their inquiry got to Herod, he was terrified, and not Herod alone, but most of Jerusalem as well. Herod lost no time in gathering all the high priests and religion scholars in the city together and asked, where is the Messiah supposed to be born? They told him, Bethlehem, Judea territory. The prophet Micah wrote it plainly, it is you, Bethlehem, in Judea's land, no longer bring up the rear. From you will come the leader who will shepherd rule my people, my Israel. Herod then arranged a secret meeting with the scholars from the east, pretending to be a devout as they were. He got them to tell him exactly when the birth announced star appeared. Then he told them the prophecy about Bethlehem and said, go find this child, leave no stone unturned. As soon as you find him, send word and I'll join you at once in worship. Instructed by the king, they set off and the star appeared again, the same star that they'd seen in the eastern skies. It led them on until it hovered over a place of the child. They could hardly contain themselves. They were at the right place and they'd arrived at the right time. They entered the house and saw the child in the arms of Mary, his mother. Overcome, they kneeled and worshipped him. They opened their luggage and presented him gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh. And in a dream, they had warned not to report back to Herod. So they worked out another route, left the territory without being seen, and returned to their own country. And basically, this scripture is what John Henry Hopkins Jr. penned the hymn We Three Kings out of. But the interesting thing about this scripture, and I just want to spend a few moments looking at this story, is it basically brings a whole bunch of reactions to the Christmas story. And what I love about this passage about the Magi is that there's a whole bunch of different responses to the birth of Jesus. And the first response is that of King Herod. And I just want to remind ourselves that King Herod was actually a great king. He was able to keep peace and order. He built the temple. He was a great builder and built the temple of Jerusalem. He was a generous man, and he often used his own money to help others and took away taxes from people to make life easier. Imagine having a government doing that for you. During the famine of 25 BC, he took some of his own gold and corn and was able to help people and feed people. And he had this reputation of being an awesome king. The problem is, he had a bit of a problem in that he was very, very suspicious. He was suspicious to the point that he became known as a murderer. If you disagreed with him or you went up against him, he'd kill you. Simple as that. If Herod suspected anyone going against your authority and power, he'd simply kill them no matter who they were. In a time of suspicion, Herod killed his own wife and his own mother. He also killed his oldest son along with two other sons. So as much as he was a great leader, a great king, Herod caused all sorts of problems. And it actually has been reported that he was so suspicious and so insane that when he was 70 and ready to die, he arrested and imprisoned the most distinguished people of Jerusalem and gave order that as soon as he died, they also would be killed because he had feared that no one would mourn him. So he wanted someone to shed tears over his death. What a nice bloke. So this is the same guy that now is saying, hey, Jesus, we want to find Jesus and we want to worship him. And in fact, what we're going to do is we're going to kill him because he's going against me. And what we know as a suspicious king is that Herod's response first was that of hatred. We actually read in scripture that it says, then Herod called the Magi secretly, found out from them where exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, go, make a careful search for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me so I too may go and worship him. In other words, find him for me. This is your mission. And we know from Herod's response that his response to the birth of Jesus was total hatred. He wanted to remove Jesus from the planet Earth. To him, Jesus was a threat. These Magi coming in and saying, hey, we're looking for this king of the Jews, this Messiah that's being born. I want to tell us about it. And yet for him, he didn't want to hear any of the history. He didn't want to hear any of the prophecies. For him, it was simply there was a threat and we needed to get rid of him. That's why he gave the order for children under the age of 2 to be killed. And we forget to celebrate that part at Christmas, don't we? We're happy with the birth. Happy with the miraculous birth and the angels and the wise men, but we forget that within that two-year period of Jesus' birth, every male 2 years and under were killed at Herod's hand because of his hatred for Jesus, because of his hatred for those potentially taking his authority. We read that in Jeremiah chapter 31. A voice heard in Ruma, weeping and great mourning. Rachel weeping for her children and refusing to be comforted because they are no more. It was prophesied that there would be so much pain when it came to the birth of Jesus. And for Herod, his response simply was, let's get rid of him. Let's wipe him out. The interesting thing is, for me, is the then response of the teachers of the law. And I want you to, you know, I've shared this a few times over Christmas period, but it just does my head in the fact that the teachers of the law were people who studied theology and studied the scriptures and they were the authority of theology of the day, that supposedly. And yet their response to the coming of the king was complete indifference. They couldn't care less. We read in Micah chapter 5, But you, Bethlehem, David's country, the runt of the litter, from you will come the leader who will be the shepherd ruler. He'll be no upstart, no pretender, his family tree in ancient and distinguished. So the prophecy of Jesus' birth, and we know even in Isaiah, there's a whole bunch of stuff there leading to Jesus' birth. And part of it was the fact that this was happening in Bethlehem. And the interesting thing that we need to remind ourselves is that when Herod found out about the fact that there was this baby to be born, he called all the chief priests and all the religious leaders and asked them, what's going on? You know, I've been told there's some baby being born. What's coming on? And they themselves quoted this scripture. They themselves said, well, actually, the prophecy says there's going to be this baby born. And that was it. Now, I don't know about you, but if it was me, I'd be going, I want to find out more about that. Is this God's word coming alive? But basically for them, they just had this complete apathy. Who cares? And I wonder whether part of it was because, again, it would have threatened their power. It would have threatened their authority, their prestige, their place in society. We don't know. But one of the things as we look at that apathy of the chief priests and the religious leader of the day is it's pretty much the same as most Australians today. Most Australians have the same apathy. You tell them about Jesus and the hope that he brings, it's like, oh, yeah, whatever. You know, and I know so many people when I share just the story of Jesus with, they go, oh, yeah, that's okay, but I won't do much with it. And it's not until they face a crisis in their life, it's not until maybe they even face death themselves that suddenly they go, actually, I want to know more about that. But in our country at the moment, there's a complete apathy. They just don't care about end life stuff. They don't care about having a relationship with God through Jesus. There's this sense of apathy. And it's interesting, though, that these same people, and I say this all the time at Christmas, the same people who really don't care about Jesus and, in fact, want to say that Jesus doesn't exist, they still enjoy having the Christmas holidays. Well, if you don't believe it, don't take them. Don't enjoy that season. Don't celebrate. Anyway, long story. I can get sidetracked there. So for the teachers and the law and the religious people, there was this apathy about the birth of Jesus. They couldn't care less. Even though the prophecies were clear enough for even Herod to want to know about it, clear enough for the Magi to want to know about it, that they still didn't care less. And yet we have then the reaction of the wise men or the Magi that we actually see, where they rock up and, as we read in Scripture, they were so blown away that they had actually found this baby. The Scriptures tell us that when they saw the star, they were overjoyed. They could hardly contain themselves. They were in the right place and they arrived at the right time. And they knew that the star was there and there was a sense where they were getting close to where it was. And it says in Scripture, on coming to the house, they saw this child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. They opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold and incense and of myrrh. You know, see, the Magi, their response to the birth of Jesus was total adoration, total adoring this child. Even though Herod didn't get it, even though the religious leaders of the day didn't get it, the Magi, they got it. There was something about this child that was going to bring change to the world. And I want to suggest today that as we celebrate this Christmas season, that we've got to ask the question ourselves, what's our response? What's our response to this day? And when we're with family, what of our family's response? And maybe it's worth even asking the question around the Christmas table. What do you think of Christmas about the story of Jesus? And discover if there's apathy, discover if they're people of peace, discover where they're sitting right now. But sometimes we need to at least ask the question, what do you think of the Christmas story? So this song, We Three Kings, was based around this scripture of Matthew chapter 2. As he was reading scripture, as he was reading this story, he started then to pen the song that we know, We Three Kings. It says this. Where are we? We three kings of Orient are, and it's interesting here, straight away, there's actually some theological issues straight away. They weren't kings, they were magi, and there weren't three. We know it just says because of three present. So some complications in there, but let's move beyond that and let's read what it says. We three kings of Orient are, bearing gifts, we've traveled afar, fields and fountain, moor and mountain, following yonder star. O star of wonder, star of light, star of royal beauty bright, westward leading, still proceeding, guide us to thy perfect light. Born a king on the Bethlehem's plain, gold I bring to crown him again. King forever, ceasing never, over us all to reign. Frankincense to offer have I, incense owns a deity nigh. Prayer and praising, voices raising, worshipping God on high. Myrrh is mine, it's a bitter perfume, breathes a life of gathering gloom. Sorrow, sighing, bleeding, dying, sealed in the stone cold tomb. Glorious now, behold him arise, King of God and sacrifice. Hallelujah, hallelujah, sounds through the earth and skies. This is a song that I'll guarantee you that in these coming weeks at the Carols events, people will sing. And in fact, being the three guys, they usually have the three good male singers, what do you call them, the tenors or whatever, and they sing this and they celebrate this. They are declaring the truth of God's word out of Matthew 2. And they are singing it. They're singing and saying that there's born a king of Bethlehem plain. Gold I bring to crown him over again. King forever, ceasing never. They're actually sharing the gospel without even knowing it. They're actually proclaiming the gospel without even knowing it. Well, I want us to have the chance to sing that. Knowing some of the history behind, let's stand and let's sing We Three Kings. What is it that you would give the Son of God? The truth is, all he wants is us. All he wants is our lives, our commitment to him, to be in relationship with him over and over again. To actually declare that he is our Lord, to acknowledge him, to remember him, to see the things he's already doing in our lives and the things he's yet to do, to give him praise and glory in the midst of the good, the bad, and the ugly. That even when it doesn't make sense, to still raise our praises and our glory to him. Even when we can't even verbalize a prayer, to at least be in the spirit and acknowledge that he is amongst us. For some, this time of the year is tough. It's not fun. It's not joyous because of the pain that brings knowing that either a loved one is not with them or knowing there's conflict or tension in a family or just knowing that people are going to be at each other's heads. You know, the domestic violence rises at Christmas time because people get on the drink and say all sorts of stupid things in their families. And yet Jesus was born on this earth so that those who believe him will not perish but have eternal life. But not only that, not only do we have eternal life, but we have God's presence and spirit with us 24/7 for those who follow him. That we can do life differently because of the Spirit of God within us. And as we share in this time of communion, as we conclude our service today, what we're doing is we're actually saying, we're declaring that Jesus is who he is. That what we read at Christmas about him being born, the virgin birth and being born and then he rises and he walks on this earth and then he speaks for 3 years in this earth and declares who he is and then eventually he dies. But he doesn't stay dead, he rises again. Defeating death. Enabling us to have our sins wiped out when we come before him like this. For me, I'm grateful that we share communion every Sunday. I know for some, they sort of say, you know, you can become a bit complacent with it. And sometimes we, you know, we've got to question the motives of why we take it. But I want to just put a challenge to you there today. That we get to reset our lives. We get to come before Jesus and say, Jesus, I'm a sinner. I've made mistakes, I've said things, I've thought things, I've done things that I know I shouldn't have done, but Jesus, I need you in my life because I want to live life to the full. I don't want to live a life that you don't want me to live. And every single one of us in the church today and those online or on the phone, there are areas in our lives that if God looks at us, he's just going to shake his head and go, oh my goodness me, that's not how I designed you to be. But the thing is, God doesn't shake his head. He actually opens his arms. And he says, I've paid the price with my son, Jesus. so that we can be in an intimate relationship together. See, that's what we do when we celebrate communion. We're reminding ourselves what it is that Jesus has done for us. Not only what he has done, but what he is yet to do. So I want to ask the helpers to come forward, and we're going to pray, and then we're going to take the bread and eat that in your own time, and then we're going to hold the cup, and we're going to eat that together as a church family. Let me pray. Father, we thank you for this time of communion, which, Lord, brings us closer to you every time, where we actually can surrender all our sinfulness, our rebellion, and, Lord, lay that at the throne, and, Lord, take the bread and the cup, reminding us that you died so that you would take all that from us, that you'd fill us afresh with your spirit, that we can press that reset button today. Lord God, we want to thank you for all that you've done and continue to do. In Jesus' name, amen.